last one.
Is there a job to do transferring a lot of the paper records to maybe online in Cloud and protected? Otherwise, you still have a lot of paper records you have to keep. In other words, is it something you print off on demand? Or does there have to be some depository with a lot of paper in it somewhere?
For residents, for such access purposes. It's not formed into a separate repository. It's got a copy is taken, and that might be redacted, so some information might be removed from it. But it's not stored somewhere else. It is taken a copy from the system to give it to them. And equally, if a resident or whoever makes such access request has a right to request that information is changed and is inaccurate, then that change will be made to the primary system to make sure that system and the systems linked to it have the accurate information on them. Does that answer your question?
Talks and paper about capacity. And one of the things that came to my mind when I was reading that, the memory of, for example, files around SEN or children's services cases, and the length of time you have to retain those records. Has that been factored in? And will there be a digital version of the archive, essentially? And is that how it will work?
Yes, we are aiming for that. We do have to keep lots of information for very long periods of time. We have actually we try to be quite innovative in our retention approach at council in trying to apply, because it can be difficult to apply retention. If you make it too granular, it's very difficult to apply it because this bit of paper has 6 years, this bit of paper has 10. So we try to take a more buckets approach, we call it. So we try and loop things into buckets, whatever makes it easier to apply retention. And that's certainly how you apply it electronically. So you apply it to an area or something like SharePoint, and everything within it would have that retention. We are looking at the paper records in the same way. So we're trying to apply retention in that way to our very long-term paper archive that we have. Some of it we'll be looking to do some back scanning on to then put that electronically onto SharePoint for the systems. Actively applying attention to our paper holdings. I don't think we'll ever get to the point that we don't have any paper because it won't be cost effective to scan all of it. But we certainly want to get to the state where we have a lot less paper than we have because we do spend a lot of paper storage. We are looking at the capacity of the long term capacity of storage for SharePoint on the 365. But the aim is to reduce paper, so therefore
I just want to follow up in terms of the long-term securing of those records that presumably is built in terms of having backup storage and one of it, because paper is subject to fast floods, but
yes.
Digital data is subject to other potential.
Yes, I mean, digital continuity is a big issue. The National Archives is a big old strategy on digital continuity because something that was accessible 20 years ago. It won't be accessible now, and certainly I think 30 years ago, if you think about the long-term retention of some of our information, the benefit of paper is that a piece of paper that's 40 years old is still accessible, might be a bit smelly, but it's still accessible. but using something which is cloud-stored, like SharePoint and the Microsoft Cloud, does build in a bit of digital resilience there, because as Microsoft changes, the formats of the data changes with it. So we are building in that flexibility. And talking about backups and disaster recovery along with the Microsoft data centers here, so we're not in our own setup. We're on what's called the Azure platform, so it's the Microsoft platform, so it is resilient.
But you've got to do that assurance.
Yes, that's it.
That's
the
reason. Can you have this, but I've seen this work in organizations that's not worked well. Is there a real presumption against a sensitive information and personal sensitive information being shared? I mean, there is this thing that you can obtain an HR department and be accessed to everyone's personal files. One example, in organisations, which I'm aware of. And you know, in the old days when you had a physical file, you had that Nalloka key, it wasn't such a problem because you had to go and ask the section head for the key to the file gather, and that's what you wanted it for. There is this thing about being online, being able to browse and kind of, where actually this sort of information does become, it's really critical that actually there's a presumption, the subtext of information, that access isn't coming to staff members unless there's a really good reason for them to be having that access. The caseworker, in a sort of terms of the case, for example, do we have a culture of that within Barnet yet, of that sort of, not just drawing the palm, you mentioned sections getting access, but actually what is it about sections, about the appropriateness of that officer having that level of access to that particular case. Is that something that you can assure us on in terms of?
I can assure you that we do take it seriously. 6-7 years ago, the council was hit by a fine, the data protection fine from the Information Commissioner's Office due to a data breach. We have learned an awful lot of lessons from that, and in effect that data breach was unfortunate because it was a theft from a home or paper, and it was paper in every other respect. So I would say we do take it very, very seriously, and we do have a good culture of confidentiality within the council.
Also, the follow-up in relation to that, because you raised it kind of good. People shouldn't take personal files home with them, but people do work on trains, and they do work at home on their computers on SharePoint. Are there, and people have people that look over their shoulders on a train. Do we have safeguards around that type of remote working?
We certainly do. When we
look
at information security, we look at it in three parts. We look at it in terms of its confidentiality, its integrity, and availability. And as you say, when you look at it in terms of paper, storing it in paper and not cabinets does give you a right to confidentiality, but doesn't necessarily give you good integrity or availability because if someone has that key to that cabinet, no one else can get into it. The benefit of electronic storage is that you have better accessibility, you have better integrity because you can ensure the integrity of the better. In terms of confidentiality there has been a wake-up call in terms of the cyber security attacks that have happened to a lot of organisations, and I think some organisations have been quite complacent about electronic security of information, but we're certainly not in the council. We do have quite a very robust and quite well-managed and quite mature policy suites and procedural suites to information security, and we have a paper handling policy, we have an information security policy, we have a great deal of policy and procedural controls. And we also follow this up extensively, so we do e-learning on data protection, we do classroom-based training to staff. We do breach management, so when a breach is reported or an initial breach, we follow it up extensively, we look into it and take lessons learned from that. So I think one thing we do is take our data protection responsibilities very seriously.
Is that constantly a reminder, just an automatic message, maybe a way of helping out, are you sure nobody can see what you're looking at? A simple thing like that may actually add to the suit, because it's a prompt. It's a reminder.
I think that's something we would be looking into. Also something we would be looking into a lot is privacy screens. On the laptop, you can put a privacy filter over it, so actually, unless you're looking at it straight on, you can't actually see it. In terms of our information security policy, we do try not to encourage our staff to work in environments that might